Was a split decision on Honkytonk Man. I voted thumbs up. I like the movie's laid-back nostalgia. Gene didn't. He thought the Clint Eastwood character was unbelievable.
We split on the Las Vegas adventure, looking to get out. Boy, did we split. He votes thumbs down. I really like this picture, so I voted thumbs up.
Then a split decision on Table for Five. Gene votes thumbs up. He thought the movie was well-written and well-acted.
Yeah.
I vote thumbs down. I thought the movie was a shameless tearjerker in which tragedy was used to make arbitrary plot points.
Three disagreements, three big disagreements from recent At the Movies programs where three movies got us saying, one guy saying, go, and the other guy saying, stop. And disagreement is the subject of the special edition of At the Movies. Joining me in the balcony, Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And across the aisle from me in the opposite corner, Gene Siskel, the film critic of the Chicago Tribune. We're calling this special show Dueling Critics, not because we disagree all the time, because in fact, I think we probably agree more often than we disagree. Mm-hmm. But when we do have disagreements, it's kind of too bad, you know, when Gene's wrong. Mm. I guess you feel the same way about me. So on this program, we're going to take another look at six movies we have major disagreements about, and maybe we'll be able to find out something about each other's blind spots.
Yeah, I hope it isn't like a Punch and Judy act, that we can maybe learn something about our specific preferences by looking in the strange corner of where we are miles apart sometimes.
Maybe find some patterns.
Okay.
The movies you're going to look at on this program include the thriller Eye of the Jury, Clint Eastwood's Honkytonk Man, two movies starring John Voight, and a movie starring a prehistoric flying lizard. Now, Gene starts with a comedy that I really liked a lot.
And I didn't. Goldie Hawn and Burt Reynolds in Best Friends, the story of a couple of Hollywood screenwriters who have been living together, and as the film begins, they decide to get married. Reynolds asks Hawn to marry him, she hesitates, and then she has second thoughts in the shower.
You didn't stay to hear my whole idea. Well, I've been thinking about what you said, and, well, you know how I feel about change. I'm not very good at change, you know that. And I'm not impulsive, you know.
Who is this?
Richard, it's very hard to be serious in a shower.
Who is it?
Please help me.
Oh. You what?
Well, I've had a lot of time to think it over, and I think we should.
What?
Go ahead and do it.
Do it.
Ooh, wasn't that funny? Wasn't that tricky? We're supposed to think they're talking about sex in that scene. I hate gimmick scenes like that, and I didn't care for a lot of this movie, frankly, because I never once believed that either Goldie Hawn or Burt Reynolds was a Hollywood screenwriter. They just seemed like Goldie Hawn and Burt Reynolds to me. And as for the film's big theme, that marriage can ruin a friendship, what's so new about that? But basically, it's that character bit. I always saw Burt Reynolds up there.
You're talking about two of the top stars in the history
right.
of motion pictures, Burt Reynolds and Goldie Hawn. People
right.
go to this movie because their names are on the marquee. They
yes.
want them to look like that. This is not a slice-of-life, realistic picture. It's a comedy.
Yeah, Roger, I think it's a little bit more than that, though, because it's dealing with a very common issue about contemporary marriage, and it's set in studios.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, it's played a little high, but, you know, Goldie Hawn, Private Benjamin, we were supposed to believe that character, Judy Benjamin. And I think that there are some stars, and Reynolds may be one of them, where there's that personal charisma
uh-huh.
is very important. He's at the level of a John Wayne, but not in this picture. I just sat there, I thought he was too old.
I can agree with you that you might not like the picture. I can believe that somebody might not appreciate Best Friends, but to say you didn't like it because it had Burt Reynolds and Goldie Hawn in it and they looked like themselves seems to be missing the whole point of why we go to the movie.
No. For some movies, yes. I didn't think it was appropriate for this one. I didn't believe them in their environment. They stuck out.
Well, I liked a whole lot of things about the movie.
Okay.
Time doesn't permit me to explain them to
okay.
you. Our next split decision is named Q. It stars a serious New York actor named Michael Moriarty and a giant prehistoric flying lizard named Quetzalcoatl that looks just exactly like a Quetzalcoatl.
Thank you.
The flying lizard gets pregnant, although I never did figure out how one Quetzalcoatl can get pregnant all by itself. It lays an egg on a in a nest on top of the Chrysler Building, and when Murray already discovers the lizard, he uses it to dispose of a couple of mob hitmen.
What is this, Quinn, huh? What, huh? Yeah, we've got to go up one more.
Yeah, our friend seems a little over anxious.
Why am I laughing at Crunch Crunch? I didn't recommend this movie, but it's far from being the worst flying lizard movie I've ever seen. In fact, there are a lot of moments in Q that I kind of enjoyed, especially when the people are sunbathing on a rooftop and the lizard suddenly swoops down and grabs them. It serves you right for sunbathing in Manhattan. But you have to admit it's a rather elementary level of entertainment in a movie. Q is a goofy movie. Maybe even makes a mistake by trying for good performances from Michael Moriarty and other good actors like David Carradine. So I voted thumbs down on Q, because I thought the movie was too ambitious for its own good. If it's going to be trash, it has to be willing to be great trash instead of having pretensions.
Well, I don't think there was anything pretentious about Michael Moriarty. What is pretentious, if you will, about the dialogue? Eat him! Eat him! I would have loved to have been on the
set. You're not being fair, because you're forgetting some of the other scenes where we get kind of the method acting introspection, and he's thinking about why he's a loser.
I thought there was a lot of fun and joy in his performance. Mm-hmm. I think it's one of the unexpected good performances. I think it makes this just from being trash to good trash. Really do.
Well, don't you think, though, that sometimes a movie like this actually needs to have scenes in it that we can laugh at in terms of its awkwardness? Because isn't there a strange juxtaposition between a good performance and really weird kind of special effects like
all right.
that?
Then let's put it this way. You saw a performance that was surprising to you, and you thought it hurt the movie. I saw a movie that was surprisingly good, and I thought it elevated it and made it well.
Okay.
There's a surprise there, nonetheless. Next at the movies, a split decision on a Mike Hammer detective story called I, the Jury.
So Miss Kendricks has been programmed to kill. That means you push a button, nothing stops him.
All right, I'll try not to push his button.
Our next split decision, a film that Roger liked and I didn't, is I, the Jury, a movie of the Mickey Spillane detective thriller with Armand DeSante as the hard-as-nails detective Mike Hammer, who works in an office on Broadway with his gutsy and gorgeous secretary, Velda, played by Laureen Landon.
What's Trigger?
Well, I'm in a Trigger now. Trigger's dead now, too?
I got you a new one.
I don't believe all these fish. I'm going to give up on that.
I love you.
These fish have pulled me. Oh, easy.
What, honey, the lip?
No, I got carbon. Is it new time of being cooped up in the office?
Why, am I being fired?
No. I got work on the outside. Prove a lot more interesting.
Okay.
See here?
Yeah.
It's a former patient at that retreat. His
All
name
right.
is Charles Kendricks, okay? Mm-hmm. He's locating. Drop everything else.
Well, what about the rest of our client?
I'll show you a little trick. Leave the phone on the book. People like dealing with an organization that's too busy for them.
Here's the pictures on Jack. I'm going to go put on my war paint.
I thought this movie was all style and very little substance, all posing and wise guy talk, and not much of a thriller. And when the murder scenes did occur, they were extremely graphic, blood all over the place, to the point of being disgusting and unnecessary. And finally, the casting of Armand DeSante as Mike Hammer. This was the big mistake. Mike Hammer is supposed to be a boozy old-timer, a Robert Mitchum type, not a pretty boy matinee idol. I guess you can tell I didn't like Eye of the Jury.
I agree with you about Armand Assani. I didn't think he was right. I love the supporting characters and the supporting actors. Barbara Carrera, Alan King, Laureen Landon is fantastic as the secretary. And when you say the movie is all style and no substance, Gene, I think style is substance in
style,
this movie.
I know that style wants to be substance, Roger, and I don't dispute the point. And I'm thinking of a film like Farewell, My Lovely, with Mitchum.
Another good movie. Yeah.
A much better movie than this, because Mitchum was right in that role. We're talking about, you're going to comment on style. I'm going to comment on the center of the movie. It is a Mike Hammer movie, and I can name, and I'm going to name them, Paul Sorvino, Charles Durning, Jack Warden,
guys. Okay, you get somebody else to play Mike Hammer. What I'm trying to say is you're complaining the thriller didn't work. Life is too short for me to care about the details of the case in a Mike Hammer story.
No.
All I care about is the world, the atmosphere.
Not the details as much. I care about Mike Hammer. Bad casting can ruin a stylistically good film.
Well, what about Mike Hammer's friends in this movie?
Yeah, well, that's what it should have been called, Mike Hammer's friends.
Good idea.
Okay.
Our next movie, I think this is another movie that has a problem with casting. I think you disagree this time. Our next movie is called Table for Five. It's a movie that has its heart in the right place, but unfortunately, it's totally out to lunch in the common sense department and badly cast. The movie stars John Voight, a good actor, in the wrong role. He plays a divorced father who wants to get to know his kids again and swoops them away on a sea cruise to the Mediterranean. His character is sort of an immature con man, and in this scene, as he tries to convince his kids of the big plans that he's got in the works, these kids can see right through him.
The water holes kick up in a high wind. That's what everyone sees. Right from their front window. A picture window. It looks out on a massive golf course, stop at Truman. With gently rolling hills, flags flapping in the breeze, and the whole thing is called Village Green.
How do people get their cars to the houses if it's surrounded by grass?
That's a good question, Truman. They park their car in a community parking lot, and they drive golf carts right to their front door.
How do they keep the golf balls from smashing the windows?
It's a great idea, Jim.
Well, I haven't got it all worked out yet, but basically people are going to love it. Special glass, that's how.
She had such a heart-rending scene, I wanted to leave the theater. Now, in
that's
that scene...
Sweet.
Sweet?
Yes.
We'll get to you in a second. Voight's supposed to be a little flaky in that scene, but the problem is he never really gets any better in this movie. The end of the film turns into a showdown between Voight and another character who's played by Richard Crenna over who's going to win custody of those kids, and that's where the movie totally fails for me because of a crucial casting mistake. Richard Crenna is sane, civilized, and responsible in this movie, and John Voight still seems to be on Planet X, so I think the wrong guy is likely to wind up
you would
kids.
Want Harry Dean Stanton, right, as the Richard Crenna role, you know.
Well, it might help make the film a little clearer than to have the wrong guy in that role.
I think it makes it more challenging to have a real good guy that John Voight has to live up to in this film. Uh-huh. He has to become as good as Richard Crenna is, the other father. For me, John Voight can almost do no wrong, except maybe in The Champ. He, I think in that scene, is one of the most touching, heartbreaking actors he has been ever since Midnight Cowboy. This is another Joe Buck kind of role of a dreamer,
We're looking at a totally
different guy. We are.
I think that from beginning to end in this film, John Voight's performance gives us a character who is so strange, so immature, and so narcissistic that it's hard to look at him.
And he doesn't want to be that way, Roger, and that's what we see.
And he doesn't change.
He does change.
Convince me.
He changes, but at the very moment, in the beginning of the picture, you can see in his heart he doesn't want to be that way. I was terribly moved by it, in a really strong way, by Voight.
Well, in that case, you don't think it was wrong casting?
Not Voight at all.
Okay.
Coming up next, Clint Eastwood. Here's some bad casting, playing a country singer in his latest film, Honkytonk Man.
Give him some coffee and donuts, Rev.
I just want my money.
Over the years, Roger and I have been pretty big fans of the work of Clint Eastwood, enjoying everything from his spaghetti westerns to his first Dirty Harry film, right? To some of his offbeat movies that he's directed, like Play Misty for Me, his first, and Bronco Billy, a recent one. They're both films that we liked a lot. But we had a split decision recently on Honkytonk Man, with Eastwood playing a country singer who knows his days are numbered, he's sick, so he hits the road for one last try at success in Nashville. Along the way, lots of adventures with his young nephew in tow, including the collection of a debt.
I think I know how we can square it. That girl, one that's just in here. I'll tell you what I'll do, Red. I'll give you her and we'll call it even.
You mean you'd
Give me the girl for the 100 you owe me?
Yeah. Why don't you talk to her yourself? Marlene! Get yourself down here, honey! Marlene, this here's Red Stovall. He's a singer and a damn good one. How'd you like to go to Nashville with him? You'd be a good girl, wouldn't you?
Nashville? Oh, my goodness, Nashville. That's my heart's dream.
Well, there you are. Just take her a few minutes to get her stuff packed.
It won't do, Arne Springer.
Oh, please take me with you, Mr. Stovall. Oh, please, I won't be any trouble, I promise. And it would mean so much to me. And the Lord will bless you if you do, sir. Oh, you don't know how long I've been dreaming of going to Nashville and becoming a big singing star. And I'm good, too. I am. The Lord has given me a great talent. You just ask anybody out there who's heard me.
Yeah, she's a mighty good singer, Red.
It won't do.
Oh, please, Mr. Stovall. Oh, please, I beg of you, please.
Can't you see he don't want you? Now, go on, get out of here. Go get me some coffee and donuts. You want some coffee and donuts, Red?
I just want my money.
I'd like the coffee and donuts. Is anybody awake? I've heard of laid back, but the style of this movie is more flat on your back. Clint Eastwood, as a country singer, looks okay, like the big hat, but he can't sing a bit. He just sort of does some heavy breathing, doesn't even try. And the style of the film, it's so restrained that any time there's a funny bit in it, like that girl complaining, it comes across as much too obvious, too forced. So that's why I didn't like Honkytonk Man.
Do you think this might have had something to do with different expectations? I mean, maybe you were thinking of Clint Eastwood at being at a higher level of energy than he usually is in this film.
But you see, what's strange to me is that I liked Bronco Billy so much, which was another character. And I'm going to go back to accepting the big man, the center of the movie, in character. I bought him as Bronco Billy, this bust-out little flim-flam guy. I didn't buy Red Stovall.
I bought him in this film. I think there was a lot of personal conviction in this film. The fact that he wanted to make it with his son, for example, and that they were going to learn about the world together. Mm-hmm. And he's going to take the son, who plays the nephew, Clint Eastwood's real son. They're going to go on the road together. They're going to find out about success and failure, life and death.
Yeah.
The scene at the end in the recording studio when he's trying to sing his big song and he just can't quite make it. I thought it all was kind of sweet and kind of nice.
Some of the scenes with the son were kind of sweet and nice, but at one point I'm sitting there, this is, goes back to the first thing, and maybe this is a peculiarity of me, but I'm looking at these big stars and I either am buying them in character or I'm not.
So what, you have the Burt Reynolds problem here. You kept thinking it was Clint Eastwood.
Yes, and I thought he also was played it so down that it was just one step even below his stone face.
Oh, I don't know. I kind of thought maybe it was interesting to see Clint Eastwood at a different speed for a change. Still to come, a movie about two expert gamblers who didn't seem so very expert to me.
Where are we stuck?
It's 170, sir.
$170,000.
Our next split decision is another recent John Voight movie, and I hope it doesn't look like I'm picking on John Voight. I think he's a fine actor. He's been in a lot of good movies. But in Table for Five, he was wrongly cast. And in our next movie, Looking to Get Out, he's stuck in a ridiculous story, totally unbelievable. Voight and Burt Young play gambling buddies who get into debt and fly to Las Vegas, try to win some money to pay off juice loans from the mob. And in this scene, Voight backs a one-time master gambler played by Burt Remsen.
How are you doing?
Doing fine, thanks.
Stay.
17.
Believe this.
What's the damage over there? Where are we stuck?
It's 170, sir.
$170,000.
How do we get out of here?
Where are you going? You're going, don't you?
You know what's
going
to happen?
What?
The desert.
Okay, raise the limit to 20,000. 140,000 across.
Market up.
Do you have $170,000?
No.
Then you better sit down. Listen, don't worry about a thing. This is negative financing. Countries do this.
Looking to Get Out is about as deep and logical as a TV situation comedy. Voight fast talks himself into a free suite, all the room service he wants, thousands of dollars in credit at that casino, without so much as showing a single identification card. And Voight and his buddies are allowed to keep their winnings, even after it's obvious to everyone that the Burt Remsen character is a card counter and that he's employed at the casino. But you see, the owner of the casino doesn't want to make a scene because his present girlfriend, Anne Margaret, used to be Voight's lover. Sure, you bet. I lost all interest in Looking to Get Out because in a movie where anything can happen, who cares what happens?
Well, I care again what happens because I cared about John Voight. That character lived. Mm-hmm. Burt Remsen lived for me. When those guys are getting into strange situations, if I'm with them, I'll follow them pretty much to any a place where anything can happen.
Well, if you wait a minute now, if you like the characters and they live for you and they're real people,
yes,
then wouldn't you like them better in a situation that you could believe was not totally made up as they went along?
Yes, I mean, better. But
don't
but,
you feel? Wait, here's Raj, a real guy. He's not being treated in a real way.
No, here's what, Raj. You're talking about in the film with I, the Jury. You said mm-hmm. a line, and I can quote earlier in the show.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You said, "Life's too short to make sure that everything turns out just right."
And we have a Mickey Spillane thriller.
We have a point, Roger,
right,
and that is that plausibility. And actually, this point comes uh-huh. from an article written by Vincent Cammie in the New York Times. Uh-huh. It was a marvelous one. I know you read it.
Okay.
Plausibility counts in movies when you don't like the movie, and plausibility doesn't count when you like the movie.
In other words, what you're saying is the ambiance wasn't enough for you and I, the Jury, but it's enough for you in Looking to Get Out.
And the ambiance in this case specifically was, again, my affection for John Voight.
Does it strike you that in that case we have exchanged positions between these two movies?
No, I don't particularly care because I'm right for this picture. Consistency, you know what they say about consistency? I'm trying to be true to the experience I had in the theater. I know you are, too.
Well, maybe that's the only thing you can be true to, is okay, what you felt while you were watching it.
I hope we haven't just eliminated film criticism. I don't think so. I think these are issues worth talking about. Okay? So much for Looking to Get Out. Let's recap our split decisions on this show. Roger liked and I disliked Best Friends with Goldie Hawn and Burt Reynolds. I, the Jury with Armand Assante as Detective Mike Hammer and Honkytonk Man with Clint Eastwood as a country singer. I liked, and Roger didn't, Q, the Thriller with Michael Moriarty, Table for Five with John Voight trying to be a good father, and Looking to Get Out also with John Voight, this time as a chronic gambler.
You know, Gene, when we were sitting here trying to decide why we disagreed and so forth, sometimes I get letters from students who say, what do you look for when you go to the movies? What are your standards or
yes,
your list of things you look for as a film critic?
Mm-hmm.
My answer is always, I don't know. I don't know. I go in, I let the movie happen to
yes,
me.
Yes, the movie starts always before we do.
Uh-huh.
And so we are looking to where it is going, apparently, and it gets derailed in Looking to Get Out for you, and
uh-huh,
it does not. There's a center to Looking to Get Out that wasn't there for you. The center, in my case, John Voight's character.
So, that's it for Dueling Critics. Next week we'll be back with four new movies to review and agree or disagree about. Next week it's Gene's turn to pick the stinker of the week's worst movie, or at least what he thinks is the week's worst movie. I'm going to wait and see what I think. Till then, we'll see you at the movies.
Ray for Raisinets. Now you can enjoy one of the all-time favorite movie candies at home. Goobers and Snowcaps too. Hooray for Raisinets. Glade Aerosol, the air freshener that instantly makes your home fresh. One spray and you'll know the difference Glade made. Super Pop Popcorn, a tender, delicious, nutritious snack at an economical price. Super Pop Popcorn, it's the one snack you can't eat alone. Super Pop.
Liana is the story of a young housewife with two children who leaves her unhappy marriage to a college professor for a romance with another teacher, a woman. But more than just being a sensationalistic sex show, the film documents exactly what happens to this woman named Liana after she makes this very big decision. What happens to her husband, to her two children, to her best friend, and to her image of herself. Here's the scene where she tells her lover her husband knows.
We've got to talk. I told him.
Oh, my God.
I'm moving out. I told him we had a fight and he kicked me out.
Where are you going to stay?
Well, I fought with you. Well, for a while, anyway.
Oh, Liana, we can't do that. This is worse than a small town here. I've got to work with these people.
Do you think it would hurt you?
I have to talk parents here into letting me run psych experiments with their children. What do you think would happen if word got out about us?
I guess I haven't thought it all out.
Liana is the new film from writer-director John Sayles, whose last film, The Return of the Secaucus 7, also displayed a fine ear for the way college-educated people talk. In addition to exposing the way lesbianism remains a major taboo in our society, the movie Liana also is broad enough to reveal what an enormous risk it is for any person to get involved with any other person. You can get hurt, just like in that scene, at any time. Liana is beautifully acted by its cast of unknowns who help make us think we are watching a personal story that is actually taking place. I'm Gene Siskel at the movies.